Called me was, would I ask him, would I come up to the hospital to be with a family, to be by their side when they unplugged the life support. On Wednesday, she and I talked briefly and was told that, well, you know, okay, we're going to do this tomorrow. And then tomorrow comes, which was Thursday, and Al, I'm going to let you take over now.
Thursday, sometimes my time gets all messed up here because of the overwhelming effect. But Thursday, we were on the way to the hospital so I could say my goodbyes. My wife and I was there. The doctor had come in, and of course my mom was there, and so was my son's mother. And basically said that the brain is not working, it's not functioning. And they said that, you know, the best thing we can do right now is hope. And right then I just said, there is a chance that he's going to make it. There was no brain activity at all for the neurologist. After I did my cries and hugged my son and told him I loved him and not to leave me, I was walking down the hall and I looked at her and I was like, man, something just hit me. And it was just like warmth hit me to the point where I just felt like nothing was on my shoulders. It was just like floating. And we got home and I said, you know what? It's going to be all right. And I said, I'm going to clean the leaves up because I'm OCD, as she says. And as we were sitting there, I started doing something. I can't remember. I was cleaning. She can probably tell you more than I can. I get a phone call and said he opened his eyes. We flew back to the hospital. My ex-wife, his mother, was there crying. Stephanie, I run in. I reach over and I look at him. The doctor had pulled him off. They had him on so much, but they pulled him off the pain medicine so he could wake up for a minute to see me. As the medicine went off, the doctor said, your dad's here. He opened his eyes and looked at me. And I looked at him and I said, I love you. And I was like, do you know who won president? And he looked at me and I said, Trump. And he went. So I knew my boy was back right then. It's just one of the things that I just knew. And then they kept saying, well, it could be, you know, no part brain function. We don't know what's going to happen. So as of yesterday, the neurologist is no longer dealing with him. He was up walking around. He's 8. I went to Texas Tech and got him a cheesy Western. He ain't he has 100% of his brain back. He has every organ's working. And I'll be honest with you, I was not a person that went to church. I mean, I just not. Stephanie is the one who called him, and here I am today because I swear there was an overwhelming feeling.
I just need you to see that same God that you read about in the Old Testament, that same Christ we read about in the book of Acts,
the same Paul that we read about in the Pauline letters, the God of all them is our God.
Yeah.
Amen. You guys getting that this morning? He's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. And he's still in the miracle business. I don't always understand it. Why sometimes he works here and other times he doesn't, at least in our understanding. But God is alive and well. And we should always celebrate the victories. Amen. That's a miracle.
Amen.
Right there. Well, we come to you this morning in a time of prayer. And we're always grateful knowing that you're a God who cares about us. That indeed you do love us. But Lord, there is just sometimes that you show up and show off in a way that we can't explain, but it reminds us that just how powerful you are. And Lord, today we can rejoice with Al, with Stephanie, with the family that Stone has awakened and he's doing great today and eating cheesy Westerns, and I'm not sure how that's going to help him, but I do know this. That you're a God who has touched this young man. Neurologists Amen. And doctors and specialists, they may have great knowledge, but you are the great physician. And you have chosen today to reveal yourself in this way. And we thank you for that, Lord. We praise you for that. I pray, Lord, also this morning, I think in this room, there were probably people who need to hear that you're still the miracle worker. And I pray, Lord, that you would extend grace to them this morning. That you would encourage them. Some have lost loved ones. I think of Ashley and Casey and the loss of Casey's dad this morning, Rob. I just ask you to minister to them, Lord. And Lord, I don't know what everyone in this room is dealing with, but you know us better than we know ourselves. And so this morning I ask you that through your Holy Spirit, that you just might fall fresh upon all of us. That you would have free reign to move in this room, up and down these aisles, Lord. I pray that we would be receptive to your Spirit's moving. I pray that our hearts and our minds would be open. And I pray, Lord, today for transformation to happen. Bind the enemy away from this place. He has no place here. This is holy ground because indeed you are a holy God. And so, Lord, as we continue to worship you this morning, we beseech you, do what only you can do and get the glory that only you deserve. In the name of Jesus, I pray. And all God's people said,
amen. Amen.
God bless you, man.
Praise the Lord.
I think about Noah, who would almost have built the ark. I think about Abraham, who almost would have went to Mount Moriah, who would almost have been willing to sacrifice his son Isaac. I think about Moses, would have almost led the Israelites out of Egypt. I think about Ezra, would have almost rebuilt the temple. I think about John the Baptist, who would almost have prepared the way for Jesus. You get my point here? Almost is not good enough most of the time. Again, I want us to look at the book of Joshua this morning. And when we see Joshua open up here in Joshua 1, we see the nation of Israel there almost to the promised land. They're at the very edge of the Jordan River. They're on the west side, and all they need to do is look across the river, and there the promised land was, waiting to enter the land of their forefathers. This is almost 700 years ago this was prophesied. What a journey the Israelites had had. You think about the excitement that Joshua and the nation, as they look over and they see the land of milk and honey, ready to enter. Think about what had happened in their times. Go back to about 2000 BC, and we go back and we realize that Abraham had been given this great calling by God to be the father of a great nation, of a great land, a nation who would worship the one and only true God. God had promised Abraham, this will be a great nation. I promise you a land. That journey inevitably took them to Egypt. Was in a good time. There for 430 years, the nation of Israel were in slavery and bondage to the Egyptians. Most of their time was building cities for the pharaohs of Egypt. Time wasn't pleasant. In Exodus 1:14, it says this: they were ruthless, being the Egyptians, to the Israelites, forcing them to make bricks and mortar and to work long hours in the fields. So we see that life wasn't easy for the Israelites when they were in Egypt, but when they cried out to God, God heard them. Even in the midst of their valley, even in the midst of their storm, God sent them a deliverer. And he sent them a deliverer in the name of Moses. And Moses was able, through God, to perform great miracles. In fact, bringing the mighty nation of Egypt to their knees and found freedom for the Israelites. Yet, with all that, God revealing himself and talking to that nation, they still rejected him when he tried to send them to the promised land. I find that just kind of blows me away. God had commanded them, and they refused to do what he had told them to do. And the result was, they spent 40 years wandering around in the wilderness. There's a cost to disobedience. And we get to this point here where we are in our scriptures today, we find that the entire generation that had rejected God has now died. Other than Joshua and Caleb, they're all gone. They're all dead. And now this new generation are on the east side of the river, and they're only one river away from entering the promised land. They're almost there. As I said, almost is not good enough most of the time. They needed to go all the way. All the way. Have you ever wondered why Christianity today in 2016 seems to have such a little impact on our culture? Have you thought about that? Why are we not seeing a difference made in our communities? Why are things seemingly no different between us and the world? Why is that? Is that good news?
No.
No, it's bad news that we're no different than the world. You see, here's what I've determined. We're living in a time and in a culture where Christians today, many of them can lie and cheat and watch pornography and do all the dirty deeds just as well as the world. To where there seemingly is no difference. And today I want to, if I can this morning, I want to suggest a reason of why we're seeing this decline of Christianity. But I don't want to just do that. I also want to propose a solution to that. And the reason is pretty simple, like what I've been talking about already. Too many Christians today are in almost land. Too many Christians today are still on the west side of the Jordan River looking over into the promised land, but they're not there. They're settling. They've not gone all the way. And I thought about this right here. For the nation of Israel, their bondage was slavery to the Egyptians. That was their bondage. But for the Christians today, their bondage is much worse than it was for the Israelites. For most Christians today, not most, but many Christians today, their bondage is sin. And we live in a time where we have somehow watered down the definition of sin. I didn't give any amens on that one. Where somehow we justify what sin is, and it's not that bad. And here's what I believe with all my heart, that many Christians today are missing out on an empowered life that God wants us to have because we're still in bondage over here to the flesh. The flesh still has us, man. They're on the brink. They're on the edge of the river. They're almost there, but almost. Just not enough. It's just not enough. Too many stop before they go all the way. Jesus said in John 10:10, I have come that they, that's us, may have life. What does it say? And have it to the full, or have it abundantly. Does that sound like a mediocre life? Come on now, church.
No.
Does it? John 4:14, those who drink the water that I will give them will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give them will become in them a spring which will provide them with life-giving water and give them eternal life. Can I say hallelujah to that scripture? I don't have to live in bondage to sin. I don't have to find ways to justify what I do wrong. Sin is sin. Wrong is wrong. Right is right. Somehow we've grayed that out. And we seem to struggle on what that is. The key words I see here, life to the full, abundant. Never thirst again. That's victory right there. And yet, so many Christians today, their cups are empty, their lips are parched. Too many go through this life never feeling satisfied, never feeling joy, never feeling peace, never feeling true contentment. And yet Jesus said in Matthew 5:6, blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they will be satisfied. They will be satisfied. And so again, when I read about the early Christians, you go back into the book of Acts and you see the people of the way, which is what they were called when they first got started, and this great movement happened after the day of Pentecost. We see that they had a lot of joy. One thing when I read about the early Christians, they had so much joy in their hearts. Was life easy for them? Not at all. Life was very difficult for them. They were being persecuted. They were being killed, tortured, put in prison. Life was not easy, but yet they had joy. They had joy in their hearts. They had contentment. So let me ask you this right here. Do you think they were any better than you?
No.
Three of you don't think so. What about the rest of you?
Who?
Do you think they were any better than you are? Do you think God cared more for those early Christians than he does us?
No.
Talk to me now. Do you really think that? Do you think God is still alive? Al?
Amen.
Is God unable to do it anymore?
No.
Huh? Has somehow his power been diminished?
No.
Do you really believe that God can strengthen you to do anything, like it says in Philippians 4:13?
Yes.
Do you really believe that? We can put good lip service to that, man. Oh, yeah, preacher, I believe that. Because I know they're all looking at me. We all got a church face on. We believe that today. We believe it on Sundays. We struggle with it on Mondays. On Tuesdays. I believe God is still alive today. I don't believe God is running out of power. I believe he is still all powerful. And I believe he is still interested in what's going on in your life, personally, just as he showed you all this week. Amen. Hebrews 13:8, God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So the problem is not God. We very clearly have that, right? The reason many of the first century Christians had joy, the reason that they were able to turn their world upside down is simple. They didn't stop at almost. They went all the way. They didn't stop on the edge of the river. I think about the early Christians this week. I thought about how they kind of crossed their own spiritual Jordan, if that makes any sense, and entered into their promised land. A land where they realized that there was forgiveness of sin. Great grace was there. A land where they realized that Jesus truly was by their side. A land where they realized that he was not only their friend, but he was their master. He was their Savior. He was their Lord. A land where they not only praised God on Sunday, but they did do it on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday and throughout the whole week. A land where the Holy Spirit and the Word of God helped them become more like Christ. A land where they believed and practiced prayer. A land where they had a peace that passes all understanding. Sounds like a pretty good land, doesn't it?
Amen.
A land where their cup was full. A land where their hearts were satisfied. A land of milk and honey. You see, I think that's the land God wants us to live in. One that is above mediocrity. One that is above average. I wonder, no hands on this one, but I wonder who might be here this morning who would say to themselves that they're truthful, I'm tired of going almost. I'm tired of settling. I'm tired. And I'm deciding I need to go all the way. I wonder how many of you this morning really can say, I want to live an empowered life. I want to have an anointing upon me, not just when I'm in church on Sundays, but when I'm at work, throughout the week, when I'm dealing with friends and family. When I'm at the grocery store, when I'm stuck in traffic. See, God could even empower us during those times. A spiritual promise land. Well, let me tell you, there's four things I've concluded we have to do if that's what we desire. Number one in your outline is this. You got to leave some things behind. In order to get to your spiritual promise land, you've got to leave some things behind. If you go back in the book of Numbers, in Numbers 14, the nation of Israel had sinned again. As I said earlier, they had rejected God. They had refused to go into the promised land. And God said this to them in Numbers 14, starting with verse 21. He said, as surely as I live, and as surely as the earth is filled with the Lord's glory, not one of these people will ever enter the land. They have seen my glorious presence and the miraculous signs I performed both in Egypt and in the wilderness. But again and again they tested me by refusing to listen. God said they will never see the land I have swore to give their ancestors. None of those who have treated me with contempt
will enter it. Those are strong words, aren't they? And then if you look in Deuteronomy 2, verse 14, it says, that entire generation of fighting men had perished from the camp as the Lord had sworn to them. So these guys had rejected God. They had prevented God's people from entering into the promised land. But now, they're all gone. They're all dead. They've been left behind. Sometimes I think we today, as Christians, need to leave some things behind to make it to our promised land. Again, I tell you, you can live above sin. The Word very clearly tells us we can do that. The problem is so many people live in the flesh. The flesh gets the best of us. I believe that there is a second work of grace that God does after salvation, where He allows the Spirit to overcome us and permeate into us. Listen to what Paul said. He's talking to the Galatian church in chapter 5. He says these words, starting with verse 16. So I advise you to live according to your new life in the Holy Spirit. Then you won't be doing what your sinful nature craves. The old sinful nature loves to do evil, which is just the opposite of what the Holy Spirit wants. And the Spirit gives us desires that are opposite from what the sinful nature desires. These two forces, check it out now, these two forces are constantly fighting each other, and your choices are never free from this conflict. In other words, you're going to choose one or the other. You're either going to live in the Spirit or you're going to live in the flesh. There ain't no middle ground right here. When you follow the desires of your sinful nature, your lives will produce these evil results: sexual immorality, impure thoughts, eagerness for lustful pleasures, I'm at pornography there, idolatry, participation in demonic activities, hostility, quarreling, jealousy, outburst of anger on 581. No, don't do that part. Selfish ambition, divisions, envy, drunkenness, wild parties, and other kinds of sin. And he says, let me tell you again. Look, Paul's talking to the church. He's not talking to the unchurched. He's talking to those who say, I profess Jesus as my God. And he's saying, let me tell you again, as I've said before, that anyone living that sort of life will not inherit the kingdom of God. Again, our culture tells us it's okay, everybody sins. We're going to do it every day. I believe that's hogwash. I don't believe we have to do that. God wants you to experience an abundant life. If it was in, look, I recognize we all fall short. This is not about being perfect. The only one who ever walked this earth perfect was Jesus. We all agree to that, right? This is not about perfection per se, but it's about having a pure heart. I might fall short. In fact, I will fall short. But my heart can be pure. I can have that purity inside. I don't have to let the flesh win. There's a battle that goes on between your flesh and the Holy Spirit day in and day out. And the Spirit of God desires to not just live in you, but to empower you. And there's a big, big difference in that. One thing to have Him living in you, another thing to have Him empower you. Can I get amen on that one?
Amen.
Here's what I've determined. That if you try to experience this abundant life, this empowered life, while holding on to a big vat full of sin, guess what you're going to do when you get to that river? You're going to sink. You ever tried to swim with something on your back? Huh? Something without a flotation device? I don't care how good of a swimmer you are. You got that junk on your back, you're going to sink. And I don't care who you think you are in Christ, if you got that weight of sin on your back, you're going to sink as you try to get over to the promised land. You can't swim with that junk on you. I think about Matthew 13, the parable of the seeds. Remember, some of the seed fell on rocky ground and never took off at all, right? The person who never came into the church. Where we come to today is that seed that took. It actually began to sprout up. It was green. Kind of like you out in your garden, you're like, hey, I got something coming up here. I like that. The beginning of something good. And it's growing. But then if you're like me, you don't get rid of all the weeds in your garden. Weeds grow faster than the good stuff. Man, weeds grow in the middle of a rock. And those weeds can begin to take root and grow and smother out the good stuff. What does that mean to us? It means, yeah, we can come to know Christ as our Savior, but we can allow the weeds to come in. Things of this world, past sin, and we won't let go of living in that way. And when that happens, it begins to choke out the life that God has given you.
Helen.
And if you don't go all the way, if you stay in almost land, you're going to end up dying. That's not where God wants you, in almost land today. Sin is serious, church. We can't take this lightly. Paul told the church in Corinth, he said, do not be deceived. If you continue to practice sin, you're going to go to hell. Hebrews 12:1. Let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. I love that scripture. There's no way the Bible tells us to do something if it's not possible to do it. We don't have to let the sin entangle us. We need to be focused on the finish line and not give up. The last thing you want to do, man, is get toward the end. You got 10 meters to go in that 100-meter dash, and you quit. There's no perseverance in that. And the word says persevere. The race has been marked. The plan is already in place. God has, and he says, I have a good plan for you. The devil tries to tell you different. But God says, I have a good plan for you. Plan to prosper you. To be there with you. To help you live this empowered life. So you got to leave some things behind. The second thing we need to do is we've got to develop a genuine faith. Number two in your outline, develop a genuine faith. When I look at Joshua, I see a man who had a real faith in God. And his faith was strong enough to cross the Jordan River. And some of you all are saying today, hey, what's the big deal about that? Well, let me give you a little history lesson about the picture that's in front of Joshua right here. And there were a number of obstacles in his way. It wasn't easy at this point. A, in your outline, the first obstacle I think of is the river itself. The river. At this time of year, the mountain snows were melting, and those melting snows, the rivers began, the creeks came down, came to the river began to swell. And at this time, the river's in flood stage. And in flood stage, the Jordan River might be 90 to 100 feet across, probably a little wider than this room, not that wide, right? And between 9 and 12 feet deep, running fast. So the river's in front of him, and he's looking at that and saying, man, I'm not for sure about this right here. No bridges. Got no boats. I got millions of people to get across this river. And he was their shepherd. And so he took every one of those millions of people and says, I've got to make sure they get across the river. You think that river wasn't an obstacle? Second thing that comes to my mind as far as an obstacle being your outline is the cities that were on the other side of the river. These cities would have been fortified. They would have had well-armed soldiers protecting them. What did Joshua have? Not much. Not much. Which leads me to see in your outline the people. That was an obstacle. If you read the Old Testament, working with it, you'll see they didn't have a real good track record. These people were quitters. Man, they were always quitting. As soon as they see God work, then they give up. So if you get a chance, take it and do some study from Exodus to Deuteronomy. You'll get a chance to see just what kind of people the nation of Israel were. Much like today. Boy, we praise God, then we forget tomorrow what he did. They were very much like that. Just like we kind of see in today's world. And I have no doubt, Joshua looked out at that river, and he said, "Man, this river's running fast. And we got white caps, man. This whitewater rafting river at this point. How am I going to get 1 million+ people across that river without losing them?" Now I look over and I see those cities. I can hear them. Fortified. Strong soldiers. Then I got this group. And I have no doubt in my mind, as Joshua looked across the river, he was thinking to himself, "Are they going to come with me? Or are they going to quit?" Because that's been their history, to quit. So he looked at the river. He looked at the city. He saw his people. And then the worst one, the last obstacle I see, is himself. Put yourself in his shoes. Has God ever called you to do something and you're like, "God, you know? What? Huh? You guys ever been there? You want me to do what? You want me to go where? Do you know those people in Exalted Church don't even smile?" I have no doubt that Joshua had this conversation with God. "You sure I'm the right one? You sure? God, you don't have me mistaken? Am I really a good enough leader to do this? Can I make this happen?" Obstacles, man. Serious obstacles. It wasn't easy for him. I thought, as I had my time this week alone with the Lord, how many people would have quit right there, looking at all those obstacles, and would have said, "I'm done. I'm going back the other way. I can't handle this." But Joshua, he didn't do that. And the only reason I can conclude is because he had a strong enough faith in what God called him to do. Faith is important, man. We live in a time where lip service is easy, but real faith? What is real faith? Look at Hebrews 11. Says faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. Let me tell you what real faith is. It's a young man with just 5 little smooth stones getting ready to fight a 10-foot giant. That's real faith. Real faith is Noah building an ark for all those animals and his family, and it's never even rained before. When I think about real faith, I think about Abraham being called to leave his homeland, not knowing where he was going to go, just being obedient. When I think about real faith, I think about Abraham climbing that mountain with his boy, not knowing anything other than, "I got to sacrifice my son." It took real faith to do that. See, real faith is lived. It's not what we talk about. It's about what we do. There's a big difference. Amen? Amen. Real faith, I've determined, conquers kingdoms. It shuts the mouths of lions, what we read in the Old Testament. It quenches the fury of the flames. It escapes the edges of the swords. Real faith can turn weakness into strength. It's power in real faith in battle. The spiritual warfare that we have, there's power in faith. It endures tortures and persecution. It stands the jeers and the floggings. Real faith even conquers death. We don't see that in this country so much, but people all around this world are dying today because of their faith. Now, where do we get this real faith at? I think that's an important question. And this much I will tell you, it doesn't come easy. And it doesn't happen overnight. Hey, how many of you, when you got saved the next day, man, you just had like boatloads of faith? That happened to anybody? You lied. I love you, man, but you lied. You had lots of faith, I got you. But it grows. Has it not grown as you walk the Lord? Right? Absolutely. What he did have, because I was there when he did it, what he did have was a lot of excitement. What he did have was a lot of joy. More than ever before, because that's what God did for me. But we begin to walk His walk. And life's not always easy, is it? But it's the experiences in life that help our faith grow. When miracles happen, and we get called from the hospital and say, hey, your brain dead son's awake, that builds our faith. When we pray and pray and pray and God answers those prayers, it builds our faith. All I'm saying is it takes experience to grow a deep, deep faith. You know, we talk about the essentials. And I think if you want to grow in your faith, you've got to use your faith. Does this make any sense?
Yeah.
Am I making any sense to anybody?
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
I'm trying to make some sense to myself right now. So when we practice real faith, what does it mean we should do? Here's what real faith tells me. I should read the Word.
Amen.
Yeah.
Because the Word says, you know, it's the truth, right?
Yeah.
Truth sets me free, amen?
Yeah.
So real faith says I should read the Word. Real faith tells me I should get on my knees and pray. That I should spend time talking to the Creator of it all. The one who has the final answer.
Yeah.
The one who knows the beginning from the end. That's real faith. And then the last thing I think that maybe this is where the almost comes in. We need to live the faith. We got to walk the walk. Trusting God even when it doesn't make any sense. Listen, Joshua understood the importance of the Word. God says to him in Joshua 1 verses 7 and 8, listen to what he says. Be strong and very courageous. He could be talking to us right now, couldn't he? Be strong and very courageous. Obey all the laws Moses gave you. Do not turn away from them, and you will be successful in everything you do. Study this book of the law continually. Meditate on it day and night so you may be sure to obey all that is written in it. Only then will you succeed. So it really is about obedience, isn't it? It really does come down to, are we obedient? When Joshua and the nation of Israel broke camp, they were ready to cross the Jordan River. The priests were carrying the Ark of the Covenant, and the priests were sent ahead of the people, which is how they did it. And I remind you again, they're looking at a river that is at flood stage. It's roaring in front of them, and the priests reached the edge of the river, and as they began to step their feet into it, the river stopped flowing. Now here's an important thing to catch. The river did not stop flowing here until the priest with the Ark of the Covenant stepped his foot into the water. He had to have the faith. And when he demonstrated that faith, God demonstrated his power. What an amazing thought. That God says, hey, this is a good truth for you. You might want to write this down. Probably the best thing I'll give you all day. Sometimes you got to act by faith before the water parts. Do you get it? So if we want to go all the way, we've got to leave some things behind. We've got to develop a real faith. And the third thing that comes to my mind is that we need to be fully armed. We need to be fully armed. Joshua 1:14 says this. Your wives, children, and cattle may remain here on the east side of the Jordan River, but your warriors, fully armed, must lead the other tribes across the Jordan to help them conquer their territory. Again, fully armed. That's the key words right there. You think about this here just for a minute. If a soldier reported to the front line standing in only his underwear, is he fully armed? That's a really weird sight, isn't it? Not only is he not fully armed, he's probably going to get killed. Maybe by his own guys. But when a soldier goes into battle, they do so fully armed, prepared. Well, shouldn't that be true for us in this idea of spiritual battle, spiritual warfare? Should we not be fully armed? Now, let me tell you something. One of the best things you can do in any battle is to know your enemy. This is not a game. Your enemy is someone who doesn't want to just make you have a bad day. He wants to devour you. He wants your soul. He wants to destroy you. He wants to knock you out. Know your enemy. Your enemy knows you. He knows your weaknesses. And he'll find those weaknesses and he will exploit them to tempt you and get you to go down the wrong path. He's the master at that. And I'm determined that one of the ways Satan works best for the Christian, against the Christian, is to keep us from going all the way. One of the ways he does best is to make us stop at almost. Almost there. Keep us lukewarm. What does the Bible say about that particular Christian? They get spit out of his mouth, huh? Lukewarm. Satan doesn't care if you come to church on Sunday. He really doesn't. He doesn't care if you say the right things, know the right church language. None of that really matters to him. As long as you stay in almost land. He just doesn't want you to go all the way. He wants to keep you non-committed. He wants to keep you half-hearted. He wants to keep you mediocre. Ephesians chapter 6 tells us that if we want to be empowered, we need to put on the armor of God. There's a wardrobe, so to speak. Study that scripture. Just quickly, we see the belt of truth. That's about your integrity. That's about your character, so to speak. The breastplate of righteousness. Again, living above sin. The shield of faith. That's what we believe, who we believe in. That's that shield of faith. The helmet of salvation. Boy, I'm glad for Jesus, aren't you guys?
Amen. Amen.
Yeah.
And then the sword. In this whole battle, he's given us all this defensive armor, and then he gives us the sword.
Yeah.
Amen.
He gives us that sword to say, hey, here's how you're going to beat your adversary. Here's how you're going to beat the enemy. Right here. This is your offensive weapon. The problem is, so many lay down, and that's where it stays. And then on Saturday night, I'm like, man, where's my Bible at? Because I got to let them know tomorrow at church I got my Bible. And now we got it so easy, we just got smartphones. We can have it on there. Probably not. Finally, we come to number 4. And it's just simply this, we got to follow God's lead. When the Israelites went into battle, they came to the Jordan River, and when they crossed the Jordan River, again, they knew who they were following. They were following the ark. And the ark of the covenant represented God's very presence. So they knew who to follow. See, God didn't leave them without direction. He didn't leave them on their own. He didn't leave them without a leader. He himself was there. His presence in the ark of the covenant showed them which way to go. And I thought, God's not left us without a leader either, has he? You know, we can come Sunday after Sunday with the great assurance of heaven and a place being prepared for us because God himself chose to leave the throne of heaven and come to this earth to walk just like we walk it, to live just like we live it, spread his arms wide and let us hang into a cross, sacrifice himself so that you and I might have life. And God didn't just save you and say, I'm not going to give you any direction. He says, I'm here for you. I've given you my Holy Spirit. You know, we're living in the greatest time of revival in the whole world. You think about this. Many times I've thought, man, it would have been so cool to walk when Jesus walked in this world. Wouldn't it? To bend his disciples, follow him and watch him perform the miracles. Wouldn't that be cool? Mm-hmm. You know, to see Lazarus thinking nasty, coming out of the tomb. To see Mary and Martha's face when they saw Lazarus come out of that tomb. Mm-hmm. Casting out the evil spirits. Man, it would have been so awesome. But do you know, we have the Holy Spirit. They didn't have that. If you have asked Jesus into your heart, you have the Holy Spirit 24/7.
Yeah.
The disciples, there was time Jesus would get alone to pray. He wasn't with them. He never leaves you. He never leaves us. Man, when you're on top of that mountain, if you just would pay enough attention, He's there. And when you're in that deepest valley, you will just look. He's there. He's not diminished. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, fear no evil, for thou art with me.
Yeah.
Amen.
You know, I don't know if you guys have ever studied Joshua very much. It's an interesting story. It's a great story, but it's also a sad part to this story. For when you read it, you realize that not all the nation of Israel settled in the promised land. The tribes of Gad and Reuben and half the tribe of Manasseh, they were content to just look across the river and see the promised land. They lived the rest of their lives without that empowerment. The rest of their lives without being in the land of milk and honey. They settled. And I thought, that's what so many Christians do today. We get to the edge. We're right there. But we don't go all the way. We settle almost. Why don't you just stand with me this morning? I know that God is speaking to some of you this morning, and He's saying to you, let's get past almost. Let's get past almost, and you got a lot of living left to do on this earth. It's going to be great living in heaven, but you got a lot of living left to do on this earth. I want you to do it with power. I want you to have that joy that I promise you. I want you to have that peace that truly does pass all understanding. But the only way that can happen is for you to go all the way and say, Lord, that river's raging. And I'm not sure what I'm going to find on the other side. And I don't know who's with me. And I'm not so sure about myself. But I know You're God. And if You brought me to this point, You'll take me to that point. That's called surrender. It's called surrender. And this morning, if you this morning feel God saying it's time to go all the way, it's time to get out of that almost land. Lee, come just play quietly if you would. I want to have you come up along this altar if you want to. You can stand up, you can sit down in a chair if you want to. Who's going to be the first to answer that call to go all the way this morning? Altar's open.
Got a spur in these four words.
You as our Savior. And I thank you, Lord, for the victory that comes with that. I thank you, Lord, that we didn't have to get ourselves all cleaned up and fixed before we came to you. We came just as we were. And I thank you, Lord, that it doesn't end there, but that you're a God who cares to walk along this path with us. That you will seek some way to have your will be done through us. That you have chosen us to be your hands and your feet. And Lord, I pray for everyone in this room today. I pray for anyone today who the enemy may be trying to defeat, to question. I pray this morning that you would extend an extra measure of grace to them. That you would remind them of just how great you are. That you care about their lives and what they're dealing with in their life. And Lord, I pray that you would fill us up as a body of believers to overflowing, to be able to go out into our sphere of influence, into this community, represented by all corners here today. May we be intentional about being on our knees and praying as we should and calling out to the Most High God. And may we be quick to open your word and read it and meditate upon it And then I pray that we might go out and live it. And do it for you. Help us in our weak faith to become stronger in that area. We need you, Lord. I thank you for victories even here this morning. Not south, for almost me. You're an awesome God and worthy of our praise. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. You can be seated. A couple of things in your bulletin. I think they're in your bulletin. This coming Friday night, again, we're having our Thanksgiving dinner. We would encourage you to invite a friend. And maybe, does everybody here have a friend? If you don't have a friend, I'm your friend. Invite me. There you go. It's good. We all got a friend. And how about this? How many of us have a friend who probably need Jesus?
Oh, yeah.
Most of us have that, too. I encourage you, just invite someone to this dinner. We want to have a great time of fellowship, but we also want to invite people who are not churched, who are perhaps not even believers, because I believe God wants to bring us together. Something we were talking about this week, the importance of the fellowship as we were together, was it not? So, again, it's Friday night at 7 o'clock. The church is providing the turkey and the dressing and the gravy and the mashed potatoes and the green beans, and we're asking you all to bring dessert. Okay, some of you all said your wives are going to cook. I've had others say, if we're bringing desserts, I got to go buy it. So, anyways, we want to have a good time. Also, mark your calendars for Thursday night, December the 1st. We're going to have an awesome time down in Vinton at the Vinton Christmas Parade. We're going to be at the Motorcycles and More parking lot, giving away hot dogs and hot chocolate and coffee and giving it to the community. That's cool stuff, isn't it? Say the church on the go, not the church sitting in a chair, but the church on the go. Well, I'm going to ask you to bow your heads. We want to take up our offering this morning. Well, I should come forward. Lord,